بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. My dear sisters and my brothers, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdul Salam, and this is the fourth installment about the decree and predestination. And in this particular talk, I will be speaking about the preserved tablet, or اللوح المحفوظ as it stands in Arabic. I really have been in a big dilemma and predicament, if you will. Should I do this talk? Shouldn't I? Because the information that you are going to hear in this talk will be the very first that maybe you've heard in your entire life. And the reason why I was in this predicament is that because some people will listen to my talk for the very first time and they have not had the foundation that most of my listeners, either on WhatsApp or on YouTube, have. Because if you have gone through the whole series from the beginning, from the introduction, then part one and part two, and then this part here, then you would be like prepared to get what I'm gonna say in this one here. But if you have not, I strongly encourage you to go and first listen to the other three parts. There is a huge amount of knowledge, because this topic of the decree and predestination were really affected by so many external factors, as you will see tonight. So if you go on the other ones, you will be able to get an idea about how politics and conflicts and scholars fighting, so all that kind of stuff affected the belief itself, and why Muslims are today where they are when it comes to this kind of belief. The decree, my dear sisters and my brothers, is something that every Muslim around the entire world believes in, and they believe in unquestionably. It's not something like you can debate, okay? It's a matter that is so in deep inside us that we accept it without even thinking about it. And people who have a good contact with Al-Quran, they will find that I will mention tonight certain things, and they'll be kind of like, oh, I never looked at that point from that angle. And this is what I want with this talk and any other of my talks. I want you to kind of like think to yourself, I'm giving you the tools here so that you learn how to search for the truth for yourself. You don't have to rely on anyone else, or from now on take anything from someone else where they just tell you, oh, it's haram, it's halal, and that kind of stuff. You have to have some kind of evidence. The decree and predestination, my dear sisters and my brothers, plays a vital role in everyone's life, because it chases you in everything you do. From which degree should you undertake, to what career should you follow, to what partner should you marry, to what car or house should you buy, or, and the list is endless. But the problem with our belief in this matter is that it always is only mentioned in bad times. There is really something strange about the decree and predestination in our life, and that it is only mentioned when things don't work as wished for. If a calamity or evils befalls a person, you find Muslims in general, friends and family and everyone that walks in Islam, especially in the masjid and all that kind of stuff, in particular they will say to you, oh, this is what Allah has written, so be patient. Yet, when people are having good fun, when they are rich and everything is working for them, you would never ever hear them say, oh, this is what Allah has written, so let me enjoy it and share it with the others. So the decree and predestination is only mentioned when the boat is sinking. Loads of Muslims make wrong decisions all the time, from picking up the wrong partner to choosing a house or country to live in. And again, when things do not work out for them to their liking or as they would have wished for it, then they have this emotional and belief safety net that this is what Allah has decreed, or this is what has been written for me, or something else around, or this was how this happened because it was meant to happen, and because it was meant to happen, it is written in the Lawh al-Mahfudh, the preserved tablet. And no matter what I could have done, nothing would have changed it. In other words, we are all bound to what is written in the preserved tablet, and we could never, ever be able to evade this fate. So this is kind of like what's going on in the Muslim world today. The Muslim mind has been messed with for centuries. The Muslim mind is a mind that consumes a lot of Islam on YouTube, on listening Quran, and all that kind of stuff, yet never seems to get satisfied or satiated. The Muslim person can listen to 100 talks about the same subject by different people without him or her really changing or adopting what they have been listening to. The problem is this. The man of religion or the sheikh or scholars, whenever they deliver a talk about a subject, they would always give us the talk, but also at the same time feed us with a touch of subtlety and quietness that the listener, that they have been listening to their talk, all the people that the sheikh mentioned in his talk, you, the listener, will never ever be able to become better than the people mentioned in the talk. It's kind of like, who are you to understand Islam better than the people that were on the 3rd century or the 2nd century or even the companions? Who are you? And the bitter truth is that our sheikhs and scholars have always throughout the centuries helped us lose confidence in ourselves, and like addicts, we depend on them to keep feeding us information upon information upon information about the same topic. And as soon as they end their talk, we are left off far more confused, dependable than we ever been before we heard the talk. In my WhatsApp group, I answer the same questions over and over and over, and there is always someone that will come and will still ask, what is the ruling of Islam on interest? Even if I have asked this question for loads of times, they still keep coming back. You see, an addict, what they do is they become dependable on whatever drug abuse they take, the intoxicant. Look at the cigarette smoker. They become an addict every time they feed, and every time they take the cigarette, they feel the addiction, they become more dependable on that drug. Exactly for us Muslims, we listen to scholars, but the scholars always deliver to us in a manner that makes us lose confidence. We're never ever fit to get what we want for ourselves. And as an introduction to this talk here, here are just three examples, an endless supply of irrationality and illogicality that you are made to believe every single day without questioning the least of anything. As a Muslim, you believe and you take as absolute everything that you are being told, especially if this matter is a matter of belief, or as they like to call it, al-aqidah. When in fact, with a little brain, it can be found that those pushed beliefs on you have been all kinds of brainwashing, and they, to stop you from thinking, they always put certain threats in there. If you think something else than what you are being told now, you will never ever see the Jannah. You never go to paradise. You are a kafir. That's it. You are done with it. And as I said, I'm going to give you three examples that are going to really make you start looking at things a little bit different. And that also will help me prove my point when I talk about Lawhul-Mahfudh or the preserved tablet. Let me start with something we all do on a daily basis. As-salat. Ask any Muslim that you know in the entire galaxy, and I speak to you directly, the one who's listening to me now, okay? How was as-salat prescribed? How we Muslims received as-salat? Look at your mind where it went straight away. It's kind of like the obvious. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, the ascension to heavens, and then when he got to the seventh heaven with Jibreel alayhi salam, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to meet up with Allah, and Jibreel stopped at some point because he could not go any further. Of course, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went from heaven to heaven, and he met prophets in different heavens. And on the sixth one, there was Moses alayhi salam, and after that, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went, and Allah ordered him the 50 salat. Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم was coming down. He met Musa, asked him what was going on. Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم told him that Allah gave me 50 salats. Musa told him, go back to Allah. Your people cannot sustain more. I've dealt with people and they could not lead a lot of salat. Go back to Allah and ask for less. You know the story. Okay? You see how your mind went straight away to that kind of... That's it. To you, this belief is just like you never thought of asking your mother, Mom, are you my mother? You've never asked her that because you never had any reason, A, and B, it just never occurred to your mind. Okay? But let me tell you that all this story is totally flawed from head to toes. And when I speak about how we received a salat, you'll be amazed. And when I talk about the Isra and Mi'raj, you will be also amazed. No other story has ever insulted Allah as the story how we received the salat, believed or not. And you never thought about it, that's okay. But at least now that you're listening to this, please open your mind. Don't just believe in anything. Question anything that is not in the Quran until proven correct. Okay? But anyhow, here is how, what, it's really difficult because the way we believe in this story, it's very insulting to Allah. And that's why in the last 14 centuries, we have, after the death of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and a few years of the four Khulafa, we've never seen any goodness until our today's. Okay? So as I said, no other story has ever insulted Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the story how He gave us a salat. Okay? And I am absolutely convinced that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is totally innocent from this story of how he received a salat. Okay? Let us use our minds and process this story for a little bit. Just a little for now, okay? And I will cover more on this topic when I speak about Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj in another talk. So Allah first ordered us 50 salat a day and a night. And then when Rasulullah ﷺ spoke to Musa and Rasulullah ﷺ went back to Allah asking for reduction, Allah went along the reduction for the sole, only exclusive and total reason that we Muslims cannot and aren't capable of praying more than 5 daily prayers. And that's why when the number got to 5, Moses still asked Rasulullah ﷺ to go back to Allah and ask for reduction from 5 to something less. And Rasulullah ﷺ, as they say, because I don't believe in this story altogether, okay, as they say, is that Rasulullah ﷺ told Musa, look, I feel uncomfortable. I cannot go back to Allah and ask for recovery from 50 to 5. That's a big bargain for us. And then they tell you that's how the salat was prescribed. Okay, I'm going to go with this belief that 50 became 5. So Allah did us a huge favor because after Rasulullah ﷺ asked Allah to reduce the number from 50 to 5, and the excuse and the reason is that we Muslims are not capable of those numbers that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had prescribed on us, and Allah accepted the excuse of Rasulullah ﷺ, it means Allah agrees with Rasulullah ﷺ. And then we are given 5 daily prayers by Allah. You know what we did, we Muslims? Then we went around and told Allah that He actually has no idea of what we are capable of. Because a nation, as Musa thought and Rasulullah ﷺ agreed and Allah agreed, a nation that cannot tolerate more than 5 daily prayers in a day, okay, is actually far more capable than that. Let's take a Muslim, a practicing Muslim who follows the Sunnah to the T, okay, with 1,000 lines under the word Sunnah, of course. Properly, and this guy is properly and seriously, so this person, every day, he or she does far more than 5 daily prayers on every single day. Comes Fajr, they do 2 rakat. And then 2 rakat sunnah, and then 2 rakat for the Fardh. That's already 2 prayers. Then he, she stays up in the masjid to make dhikr until the sun rises. Then they pray 2 rakat. That's a 3rd salat. Then around 4 a.m. they pray 2 rakat duha. That's a 4th salat. Then comes Dhuhr, he, she prays the 4 rakat of Dhuhr, the sunnah, the before sunnah. That's the 5th salat. Then comes to the Dhuhr itself, they pray the Dhuhr itself. The sixth, then they pray the Sunnah after Dhuhr, that the seventh Salat. Okay? And then later on comes Asr, they pray four rakat, that eight. And then comes Maghrib, nine. The Sunnah of Maghrib, 10. And then Isha comes in, the Sunnah before Isha, 11. The Isha itself, 12. After the Isha, the Sunnah of Isha, 13. And then they pray the Shafa, 14. And they pray the Witr, 15 Salat. And if we go with the Sunnah, that after each Adhan there is two rak'at, that makes, add to that 15, another 5 Salat. And then we have 20. And then the person, guess what? Wakes up at night and prays, and that's 21 Salat. So in a day, every Muslim prays 22 Salat, when we told Allah we could not do 5. You see how we've insulted Allah far beyond, it's beyond imagination. A total of 21 to 22 daily prayers. And when Rasulullah ﷺ told Allah that we couldn't do more than 5, Allah went along and He gave him that. You see how we insulted Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we do that every single day. But you know what? Your mind is so brainwashed, you never ever questioned this matter. You just accept it like that. And they tell you the story in the masjid. They tell you from 50 to 5, and how bountiful Allah is, how merciful Allah is. And He knew we Muslims couldn't do more than 5, so He reduced it to 5. And then we go around the corner and we tell Allah, we got you here. We are far more capable than that. We can do actually around 20 daily salat. And we had it reduced to 5. You know what? We make fun of the Jews and Christians for the way they treat Allah, the way they relate to Allah. And yet, we do insult Allah daily in the name of the Sunnah. The Sunnah pray this, the Sunnah do that. Rasulullah ﷺ, who bargained for the Muslims from 50 to 5, He Himself asks us to do far more than the 5s. He said we couldn't do more. Musa made an error. Musa was a liar. Astaghfirullah. Because he thought he knew us. And Rasulullah agreed with Musa. Subhanallah. And worst case, Allah. We made Allah. So the question is, if you believe that Allah had reduced the number from 50 to 5, you are not allowed to do more than 5 daily prayers. And they are just like you do Fajr, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha. That's it. Nothing else. But if you believe, like me, that all the story didn't take place for a lot of flaw, a lot of problems and contradictions, all that kind of stuff, then you can pray as much as you can. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said that in the Quran to pray a lot. But anyway, as I said, I'll speak about this later on. But I just wanted you to have an idea about this issue so that you start thinking for yourself, and that later on when I talk about the Lawhul-Mahfudh, I will say things that you will not be shocked. Point number 2, our Muslim calendars. We are told that it was at the time of the second Khalifa, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, that our calendar, or at least the year, was invented, and that the Hijra migration of our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was used as a reference point from where they started counting. However, the lunar calendar they invented and we are still following today is flawed, and it really is flawed. Have you ever seen a calendar where spring comes in winter? We Muslims, we just had spring. So Rabi'ul Awwal, Rabi'ul Thani. In the Rabi'ul Awwal was somewhere in November. Rabi'ul Thani was in December. How come the first spring and the second spring in the Muslim world come in the winter land? It's unbelievable. So my question is, what kind of calendar did Rasulullah ﷺ have so that Ramadan always came at the same time? Because Ramadan, from where it comes in autumn, in fall, in the time where the day and night are equivalent in kind of length. And why were the Muslims at the time of Rasulullah ﷺ fasting every year at the same time? And why is our Ramadan a vagabond? He is a homeless dude. Every year you find him somewhere else. you understand my point, but you never think about it. Why? Because whenever the scholars deliver a talk about these kind of topics or other topics, they deliver with Al-Shafi'i said, Al-Bukhari, the most authentic book after Allah, Muslim, this, that, and you feel like a cockroach in front of these people. You can't use your mind, even though Allah says in Al-Quran that He has made Al-Quran easy to understand. But these people have managed to drive into our minds that we are stupid idiots who cannot understand the words of Allah until and unless a scholar explains them to us. If Quran, you can't understand it your own self. You have to understand it the way Ibn Kathir did, At-Tabari did, or this or that scholar did. When we all know that the Quran, the book of Allah, is a book, is a speech that Allah has designed so that we understand it. This is not some kind of code from the bank that you don't understand and you need a lawyer to explain it to you. No, you don't need. Al-Quran is simple, easy, shmeezy, peasy. You read it and it's a book of guidance to mankind. Allah didn't say mankind cannot understand the Quran until and unless explained by scholars. No, Allah said that this book is easy, peasy. Anyone can understand it. So why we Muslims, you read the Quran, we kind of like everything and we are still the worst people on earth? It's because of the input of those men of religion that have taught us to be addicts, dependable on them, and they have abused our trust and did what they did with our Islam, so much so that we today, we don't even know where our head. After 14 centuries, you would think we have Islam covered, right? But actually now you are discovering that, I've been like, for the last 40 years of my life, I was insulting Allah with the number of salats and I never thought about it. Yes, because your brain is totally out of order, or at least mine also as well. But anyhow, so, and the third topic, now that you got an idea, the third topic is actually the preserved tablet itself, Lawh al-Mahfudh. And before I start on this topic here, I would like to say that the biggest problem that everyone, including myself and everyone else, faces is that while we Muslims unquestionably believe that anything that happens to us was already decreed and written in advance, okay, before even we were born, but we also at the same time we believe that Allah has equipped us with a brain and the free will to do as we please. After all, this is why Judgment Day exists, is so that Allah holds us accountable for what we have done. And why would He do that? It's just because He has given us the free will to do. But we Muslims, we still believe that everything is pre-decreed and there is nothing much we can do but to follow the code. Just like your computer, you see, or your telephone, the phone, the apps you use. You can't force the app to do something it's not coded to do. You can never blame your WhatsApp message for not dancing to you or for not cooking, because you know it is not, or it was not coded to do that kind of things. Okay? So again, us, if Allah has coded us to only cook, why should He blame us when we can't drive a car? But this is what we are on. So there is one question that non-Muslims keep throwing in our faces all the time. And believe me, every time before I plan or before I do a talk or even in my spare time, I listen to a gazillion of different talks from Christians, Jews, debates, all, you name it, and I listen to you, okay, to them. And there is this question that keeps coming back to us. How come you have an absolute free will to do as you please, knowing that you are solely responsible and accountable for your deeds and decisions, and on Judgment Day, Allah will question you as the primary and sole doer and primary suspect for what you have done, while you also believe that Allah has written everything in something called the preserved tablet, and that is what's written for you, that's your personal book, that's what's going to happen to you? And you've got, no matter what you do, you can't get out of what has been coded in your genetic code. Just like a computer, as I said, there is only one thing that you can do, and there is not much of a choice you have for that. How come all our actions are ours, while at the same time, when we were born, we found them already waiting for us to be executed, just like the Matrix movie? Okay, Neo has been made, so many things, and you've got all the Matrix things. And that idea evolves around this. The state of such confusing set of beliefs, my dear sisters and my brothers, that we Muslims are, oh God, we are always open to attacks from anyone out there willing to throw them our way. Scoop the internet and you will find countless challenging questions on this topic. But upon studying all these questions, they all gravitate around one fundamental question, and that is, if Allah already wrote everything before we were born, if our life has already been planned and panned out for us, why are we then held responsible for what God, Allah Himself, has already decided and predestined for us? The very sad news, my dear sisters and my brothers, is that all that is out there at the moment on the internet does not answer this very simple yet complicated question. So many scholars have tried their very best to answer this question, and every time you put them in a corner, I will bring this later on, inshallah, there are statements they say, well, this is what Allah has written, He's going to put you in hellfire, either you like it or not, deal with it. That's it. That's it. Free will has gone out of the window when they felt cornered. But until I get to that thing, there, many scholars have tried, as I said, their very best to answer this question, but no matter what they did to answer this question, they all end up saying the same thing. The thing that you already know, and the reason being is that they all base their answers on the same text. And because one text, if that scholar has made an error, and if you've got 1,000 scholars that rely on one wrong error person that made it, then you've got 1,000 errors. And this is our case today. All our scholars rely on the same books, on the same text, on the same thing, and that's why they always end up giving us the wrong answers. And the question remained unanswered until our times, because alhamdulillah, in our times, there were sheikhs, there are scholars, there are thinkers, there are doctors. And what these people have done, they say, you know what, let us put the past on hold and let us use our mind. Yes, we use some of the rules from the past and some of the things, but they don't push us to think in a certain manner. Let us use our own thinking to see what Allah wants to talk to us. You know, every time you hold the Quran in your hand, Allah is talking to you. He's addressing you directly. Allah didn't tell you in the Quran before you start reading, first of all, go and get a sheikh and then let him tell you what I'm saying. No. Every time you open the book of Allah, He is talking to you. So now we are going to see about this Lawh al-Mahfudh from what Allah wants to tell us Himself, not what the scholars of the past have cooked up for us. You know, they noodled up something and we stuck with it. Now, so everything is about Lawh al-Mahfudh because the decree and the predestination, all of this matter evolves around what's written in this Lawh al-Mahfudh. Okay, this is why it's so important, this introduction about this Lawh al-Mahfudh. I strongly recommend that you listen to this talk while in total freedom, not while doing the dishes or driving. Maybe driving, yes, you can do that, but not when you are busy doing something else. And I strongly would recommend you listen to this talk 2 or 3 times. And then get pen and paper and take notes. You need to get out of the dependable addict that you have become. You need to get your own way. You see, all I am doing is I am acting like your mother or your father, holding your hands and you, as you learn how to walk. But I'm not going to hold them for eternity. Just like your child, remember, once they got to an age where they can walk independently, whenever you want to grab their hand, they take away their hand. They don't want you to hold their hands any longer. Okay? So I wanted to take pen and paper and start dividing your thinking. Just like the number of salat, now you've got to, and you go, what? How come have I always been ignorant about this? Wow. You, by pen and paper and taking what I'm saying and work on it, you will develop a research and technique that will help you, bi-idhnillah, get to the truth upon which Allah will reward you on Judgment Day. Ameen. So by now, so please do take pen and paper, take notes, and because you want to get to that elusive question, if it all already written before you were born, and if your life has already been planned out for you, then why Allah holds you responsible on Judgment Day? What does the Quran say about this one? But you know, so get a pen and get ready to take notes, and there will be a lot to cover. First thing first, what is Lawh al-Mahfudh? And what is the correct translation of this decree element? Well, though in Arabic it has only one name, and that is Allah al-Mahfudh, as the scholar would say, in English when you translate Mahfudh Hafidha is when you safeguard something. This is the root word, okay? And then protection, and then you guarding, well guarding, conserved, stowed, find, all these are adjectives, but the safeguard is the main word. So here when we say Allah al-Mahfudh, it means it is the safeguarded tablet. And for easiness and simplicity, I'm gonna call it the preserved tablet, as in the safeguarded tablet. And so Allah again has mentioned in the Quran that He has written everything in Allah al-Mahfudh, was this terminology used by Allah or His Messenger. And that's what we are going to see in this talk altogether. Believe it or not, there are many misunderstood terms in Al-Quran. Even though we have hundreds of books of tafsir written by different scholars throughout the past 1,400 years, but when we deeply look into the book of Allah, we find that some of them are still very misunderstood. Especially that since all our scholars tend to copy each other and paste from each other. Many times you find one error made by one scholar, and that error keeps traveling through time just because one other scholar had praised that scholar and that book, then everything taken in that book becomes something of a sanctified. So today we've got some books that are far beyond criticism, and so much so that no matter what's wrong in those books, we still cannot change them. We still cannot correct them. Bukhari, Muslim, all these books of hadith, even though they contain calamities, but they stay with those calamities just because you can't touch al-Bukhari, and that is that. But anyhow, so the degree of authenticity in these books is always here and there. But some words have not been exploited properly. Really have not been exploited properly. And a deep look into the book of Allah helps us understand what does Allah really want. Again, some of the scholars these days, they always cover up the mistakes of any scholar or sheikh that they have existed before. So even if a sheikh makes a wrong fatwa before, Ibn Uthaymeen, Bin Baz makes a wrong fatwa before, we cannot say they are wrong. And I've had this, I've had people mad at me. How can you say Ibn Uthaymeen is wrong? And I said, he's not a messenger, he's nothing, he's just a human being. But that is the mentality of people, and they think they are doing something great when in fact they are not. So the problem of covering up the terminologies, covering up scholars, covering up books, is actually creating a lot of problems with us. Also, there is another problem, and that is when some error has been mentioned by one scholar. And that is really, really hurting us much because it keeps coming back. It just takes one scholar to say that Allah wrote in Allah al-Mahfudh, and the belief in the Lawh al-Mahfudh, the safeguarded tablet or the preserved tablet, becomes an integrated belief, part of our very core Islam. And believe it or not, that is just that. there is nothing of the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not in the Quran, that mentions Lawhul-Mahfudh that Allah has written on it. Yes, Allah has mentioned Lawhul-Mahfudh, as we shall see, but not in the way it is being preached today. And since our talk is about Lawhul-Mahfudh or the preserved tablets, okay, then we will need to cover a few other terminologies which have caused head scratching for a lot of people. One of them is Ummul Kitab, the mother of the book. When Allah mentions the mother of the book in the Quran, what does He really mean by that? Also, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He has written in the book, for our scholars, Allah has written in the Lawh al-Mahfuz. That's as simple as that. But is that what is true really? Well, not really true. Also, the terminology of al-qada itself, what does it mean? And the terminology of al-qadr itself, what it mean? What does it mean itself? But since we are on about Lawh al-Mahfudh, I will delay the other terminologies about qada or qadr later on, because you need to first understand the Lawh al-Mahfudh, the preserved tablet, the pen, and the writing and that kind of stuff. And then when we get to al-qada and al-qadr, you will understand them, bi-illah, far more easier than if we did them before we spoke about Lawh al-Mahfudh. Again, that elusive question, if all is already written, decided before we are born, that our life was planned and panned out for us, then why should Allah hold us responsible on Judgment Day? So this is what we want to answer, because this understanding this will set us free, and suddenly we Muslims, we start inventing, we start becoming positive players in the world, just avoid being consumers as we've always been. But anyhow, so what does the Quran say about the terminology of Lawh al-Mahfudh? Well, it really, ya Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the word Lawh al-Mahfudh, in this word Lawh Mahfudh, in Surah Al-Buruj, and that is the Surah number 85, at the last ayah, okay, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is ayah number 22. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks to us in this surah about a particular event that took place back in time, where a king took it upon himself to kill people just because they believed in Allah. وَبَا نَقَمُوا مِنْهُمْ إِلَّا أَن يُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَمِيدِ. And they only resented them, i.e. the king and his people, his army, his government, and the people who follow this king, resented them, those believers, just because they believed in Allah, Al-Aziz, the very mighty one and the praiseworthy. So this is, and then how they threw them on fire and killed them all. And then Allah subhanahu at the end of it says, بَلْ هُوَ قُرْآنٌ مَجِيدٌ. But this is certainly a glorified, it is a glorified Qur'an. Qur'an full of glory. فِي لَوْحٍ مَحْفُوظٍ. In a safeguarded tablet. Notice in this ayah, and if you are close to your Quran or the translation, please go and get it. It's surah number 85. Look at the far bottom of that surah, and it should say, but this is a glorified, or it is a Quran full of glory, in a lawhin mahfuz, in a garden tablet. It must not say in the Lawh al-Mahfudh, in the garden. It must be an indefinite article, a, not definite the. Notice that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala referred to the Lawh al-Mahfudh here with an indefinite article and not a definite one. This is extremely crucial, because the Quran is just in a guarded, safeguarded tablet. And that this tablet itself is elsewhere, but it is not the Lawh al-Mahfudh in which Allah wrote everything. Because somewhere else in the Quran, Allah refers to this guarded tablet as Ummul Kitab, the mother of the book. So what is the mother of the book? Does it refer to the guarded tablet, Lawh al-Mahfudh itself? Well, let us look in Surah Az-Zukhruf, and this is ayah, Surah number 43. From the ayah number 1 to 4. From number 1 to number 4, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, حاميم والكتاب المبين. حاميم by the clarifying book. So Allah here swears by the Quran that is clarifying. إِنَّا جَعَلْنَاهُ قُرْآنًا عَرَبِيًّا لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ. We have made it into a Quran in Arabic so that you realize its content. وَإِنَّهُ فِي أُمِّ الْكِتَابِ لَدَيْنَا لَعَلِيٌّ حَكِيمٌ. And that book, the Quran that we have today, in the mother of the book, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is highly praised, highly exalted. Let me read some translation of the last ayah that I just mentioned from a Quran.com website. وَإِنَّهُ فِي أُمِّ الْكِتَابِ لَدَيْنَا لَعَلِيٌّ حَكِيمٌ. They say, and indeed, it is in the master record with us, highly esteemed, rich in wisdom. And number two, and surely it is in the mother, i.e. the essence, and then they say the preserved tablet of the book, close to us indeed, ever exalted, ever wise. Number three, and verily it, i.e. the Quran, is in the mother of the book, again, Lawhul-Mahfudh, before us indeed exalted, full of wisdom. Number four, and lo, in the source of decrees which we possess, it is indeed sublime, decisive. Five, and indeed it is in the mother of the book with us, exalted and full of wisdom. Six, and verily it is in the mother of the book in our presence, high in dignity, full of wisdom. Number seven, and it is in the mother of the book, i.e. the preserved tablet, with us, surely sublime, full of wisdom. Number eight, it is truly exalted in the source of scripture, kept with us and full of wisdom. Number nine, indeed, it is transcribed in the original book with us, sublime and full of wisdom. And number 10, and indeed, it is, still speaking about the Quran, in the master record with us, highly esteemed, rich in wisdom. Let us study this very ayah, which can open up to us new frontiers, because Allah has mentioned in these few ayat in Surah Az-Zukhruf from 1 to 4 some very interesting facts. Allah swears by the clarifying book that is with us, i.e. that is Al-Quran. Then He reveals to us that the Quran's original language is not Arabic. People say Allah spoke Arabic, Adam spoke Arabic. All that is absolutely nonsense. The original text of Al-Quran is not Arabic. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, before sending it to the Arabs of Quraysh upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, rendered it into Arabic to facilitate its comprehension, since it was revealed to the Arab tribes named Quraysh and then to the rest of peninsula. What this also means is that the original text is in a manner that is totally different to Arabic. From that original language, Allah rendered it into Hebrew, and it became the Torah. And then Allah rendered the original text, into Aramaic, and it became the Gospel, and He gave it to Jesus, and it was the Gospel. And before that, He rendered that text from the preserved tablet of Lawhul-Mahfudh of the Quran into some language spoken by Abraham, and it was the scripture of Abraham, and so on. So the original text of Al-Quran, we don't know what it is, but Allah renders it into different languages depending on the people He sends. That original text of Al-Quran, that one there is in a preserved tablet, in a Lawh Mahfuz, and from that preserved, indefinite, a, it's not there, it's a. Let me give an example to understand the a and the there. I know you speak better English than I do, but it helps. If you and I are walking down the street and we pass by a red car, and then later on you and I meet up and I told you, you know that car, or you know the car, and then you straight away understand, I told you, oh, the car has been stolen. And you go, oh, who stole it? Straight away. But if I came to you and I said, a car has been stolen, what your next question would be, who stole it? What's going on? See, you use the for something that you are aware of, that you know of. And you use a for something that you don't know and you're not aware of. So when Allah says, إِنَّهُ لَقُرْآنٌ مَجِيدٌ, that it is a glorified Qur'an, in a preserved Lawhul-Mahfudh, Allah is not speaking about something definite that He has explained to us in Al-Qur'an. That book, that Qur'an exists in that Lawhul-Mahfudh, which is Ummul Kitab. It's the mother of all books from which all books were taken from. The original language is in there. When Allah wants Arabic, He takes from the original language, turns it into Arabic, gives it to us. That's the Qur'an we have today. Because remember, when Allah speaks what took place between Musa and Fir'aun, Allah tells it to us in Arabic, right? Do you know why? Because Allah did the translation from us. Allah did the rendering of information already for us. Fir'aun never spoke Arabic. Moses never spoke Arabic. Jesus never spoke Arabic. Abraham never spoke Arabic. Neither did Nuh. None of the scholars, of the messengers and prophets, but even Adam, Shaitan didn't speak Arabic. You see what you understand what I'm saying? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He reports to us the Quran in Arabic, He says, Qala, He said, He did, He went in Arabic. As if the whole thing happened in Arabic, when in fact the original language of the Quran is not Arabic. Later on, when I talk about Allah and the words, I will tell you what the original language of Al-Quran, because Allah mentioned it in Al-Quran itself, and I will also share with you what kind of language Allah uses for His knowledge, because it already is in Al-Quran. It's mind-blowing. It's really mind-blowing. But anyhow, therefore, Ummul Kitab in this ayah refers to the main book that contains the original text from which all other books that were sent to mankind were taken from. And not again the guarded tablet of our action. This is a very interesting concept. Somewhere else in the Quran, Allah sheds more light on the concept of the mother of the book, or Ummul Kitab. This concept is mentioned in Surah Ali Imran. That is the surah number 3, in the ayah number 7, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هُوَ الَّذِي أَنزَلَ عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابِ. It is He, i.e. Allah, who has sent down upon you the book, i.e. the Qur'an. مِنْهُ آيَاتٌ مُحْكَمَاتٌ. In this book, that from it are some ayat that are precise. I.e. these ayat, they carry just one meaning. They can't have other one. The ayah is closed. It cannot have more than a meaning. And then Allah says something very interesting. He says, "Hunna ummul kitab." They are the mother of the book. Subhanallah. Wa ukhru mutashabihat. And some other ayat mutashabihat, whose meanings are cryptic. And then they have more meanings, and it's up to us to get those meanings out and apply them as the condition, the situation, the time calls for. So subhanallah, the ayah that is muhkama, the meaning is it's closed meaning. It can only have one meaning. And that Allah is saying is al-kitab. So let us see what the scholars of translations said about this mother of the book. They say it's the foundation of the book. It's the cornerstone of the scripture. It's the essence of the book. It's the substance of the book. The principal ayat of the book. They are the core of the book. Basically, muhkamat, the ayat muhkamat, are the essential parts of Al-Quran. And Allah uses the ayat al-mutashabihat, other parts of Al-Quran, to explain what those muhkamat hold of the meanings. For example, yeah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbids us from killing a soul. That's it. This ayah is muhkamah. You can't kill a human being no matter what. And then Allah in other ayah tells you, but you, if that human kills another soul wrongly, then you can kill him. If that person there fights Allah promotes violent evil and declares war on Allah and His Messenger and basically an outlaw person, and you get hold of these people, kill it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains what He has confirmed in one ayah. The Quran has got three different types of ayat. Yeah, it has al-muhkama that has only one meaning. Okay, it cannot, Fir'aun summoned the magicians, it cannot have 600 meanings. He called them, they came, that's it. And there are other ayat mutashabiha, they are called similar in the meaning. And they usually act as just a kind of explanation to what has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defined in that muhkam, that closed ayah. And then the third type of the ayat is they act just like a content of the Qur'an. For example, when Allah speaks about the Qur'an as a clarifying book, that ayah itself is just, it tells us about what the Qur'an is. There is no law for us to apply. Another ayah in Surah Al-Ra'd. Surah Al-Ra'd is the surah number 13 in the ayah number 39. This ayah has caused a lot of problems to people because of the misunderstanding about it. Allah says here, يَمْحُ اللَّهُ مَا يَشَاءُ وَيُثْبِتُ وَعِنْدَهُ أُمُّ الْكِتَابِ. In the nearest translation is that Allah wipes off or erases what He wills and retains or confirms what He wills. And with Him is the mother of the book, or the mother book. At first sight, this ayah gives the impression that all, including human actions and deeds and all whatever is to be or has been, is contained in the preserved tablet. But to really understand this ayah, first let us see in what context was it revealed. It is extremely dangerous these days that Muslims truncate an ayah just like they take part of an ayah and they apply it as a universal truth. For example, how many times have you heard something like, oh, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ma yantiqu anil hawa, he doesn't speak out of his own desires. In huwa illa wahyun yuha. It is, but whatever the messenger say is a revelation from Allah. You hear this all the time. And with that, they made whatever comes out from the mouth of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a revelation, when in fact it is not. They have truncated, taken a part of an ayah from a whole context and applied it just to suit their own desires on whatever point they want to drive in or support. The same thing, my sisters and my brothers, whenever someone tells you one ayah from Al-Quran, don't take the whole thing. Just tell them first in what context was that ayah mentioned. Because this is what happens. They truncate one ayah, just a little bit or two, three words from an ayah of the Quran, and that has a meaning. But elsewhere in the Quran, you will find that that ayah there contradicts with another ayah. And we end up in a tennis ball game. Let me give you an example, yeah? If you are reading a book, a thriller book, okay? And in the book, the guy says, for example, oh, I don't like negative attitude. The cold approach, I hate it. And then you go, okay, this person doesn't like it when people take a negative approach towards them. But later on in the book, you find that this guy uses a cold approach to get to some information. Now, at one point, this guy doesn't like cold approach, and the other one, he uses cold approach, and your mind goes, okay, why is that? Use, don't use, it's contradictory, right? Well, because you've just taken away the word from a context, and then you just took a word against a word. And this, more and more often, it's unbelievable how much they use these things. They just truncate part of the Quran, and you end up with a calamity. One of which is, يَمْحُ اللَّهُ مَا يَشَاءُ, that Allah erases everything He wants, or affirms and confirms something, and He has the mother of the book. And they say, well, and then people, you get people asking, does something that is written in the major book, the preserved tablet, can it get erased? And then you, and debate goes there. How is this going to affect us? We hear people in Ramadan, they say, Ya Allah, if you have written my name amongst those people that are going to hellfire, please change it. If you have written my name in the Lawhul-Mahfudh that I am going to go to hellfire, change it. And they making fun of the whole religion of Allah. If you know that Allah has written your name in Lawhul-Mahfudh, it ain't gonna change. You make dua or you don't make dua, you headed to hellfire. And then again, who told you that Allah wrote your name in Lawhul-Mahfudh? Who told you that? Well, you see, it all starts with truncating one part of an ayah and say, when Allah writes or wipes something in Lawhul-Mahfudh, that's it. Because we've taken that ayah out of context. This is why we need to go to the context. Al-Quran did not come in singular ayah. Each ayah is individual. No. All the Quran came in a context. The ayah, they all work always. They have one spinal topic that they deal with. Allah used 5, 10, 15, whatever number of ayat necessary to explain a topic. So here when Allah says that يَمْحُوا اللَّهُ مَا يَشَاءُ وَيُثْبِتُ, that Allah wipes off or erases off what He wills and confirms and retains whatever He wills, and with Him is the mother book, we gotta first of all see what context does this ayah apply. Well, as it turns out, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let's go a couple of ayat before and a little bit until we get to this ayah. Allah says in the Quran, قُلْ إِنَّمَا أُمِرْتُ أَنْ أَعْبُدَ اللَّهِ وَلَا أُشْرِكَ بِهِ. Say, Muhammad, to the people of Quraysh, that I was only ordered to worship Allah and not associate anything or anyone with Him. Then Allah clarifies the points rejected by the other receivers of the scripture, and for that He says, وَكَذَلِكَ أَنزَلْنَاهُ حُكْمًا عَرَبِيًّا. And it is with the same directive, like He gave to Moses, like He gave to Jesus, that we revealed to you, Ya Muhammad, this Quran in Arabic. It's the same Quran, it's just to Moses it was given in his Torah, his Jewish language, Aramaic gospel, to his Arabic. Okay, so the Jews should understand this because it is in their book, it should say this. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَئِنِ اتَّبَعْتَ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ بَعْدَمَا جَاءَكَ مِنْ الْعِلْمِ. And if you were to follow their desires after what has come to you of the knowledge in Al-Quran, مَا لَكَ مِنَ اللَّهِ مِنْ وَلِيٍّ وَلَا وَاقٍ. None will be your supporters against Allah, and none will have the power to shield you from His punishment. Then Allah responds to them directly, through the Quran, of course, or indirectly through the Quran, by stating that the way He is treating the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam amongst them, He did the same with Moses when He came to the children of Israel. And then Allah says, وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا رُسُلًا مِّن قَبْلِكَ, we have dispatched messengers before you. وَجَعَلْنَا لَهُمْ أَزْوَاجًا وَذُرِّيَّةً, and we made for them wives and offspring. وَمَا كَانَ لِرَسُولٍ أَن يَأْتِيَ بِآيَةٍ, and no messenger had the power to produce a miraculous sign, إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ, except with the permission of Allah. لِكُلِّ أَجَلٍ كِتَابٍ, for every matter has a set time. Then Allah mentions all messengers share with each other what is the one thing that all messengers share with each other, and that is they all got their scripture from the same source as the one from which the Quran was given to the Prophet Muhammad, as I said earlier on. The source, the mother of the book, contains all what humanity needed through time, and in from that source Allah managed the scriptures given to all messengers. From that source Allah wipes off. So when He gave to Moses, He gave him some laws and some rules and everything. But when He took from that same source, from al-Kitab, from the mother book, when He gave the revelation to Jesus, son of Mary, what did Allah do? He erased some laws and He affirmed some laws. For example, in the Torah of the children of Israel, if the child is disobedient to the parents, his punishment or her punishment is death. This is why when Moses was with the pious man in Surah Al-Kahf and they saw a kid playing and the man killed the kid, Moses alayhi salam got angry because Moses didn't know that the child was disobedient to the parents. That's why later on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains that the parents of the kid were pious, and where the kid was to live, he would have forced them into disbelief. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew that, so the kid got punished because he was disobedient to the children. That was the law of the children of Israel. Musa had the law. The only thing that Musa didn't know when the event took place, if Musa knew that the kid was disobedient to the parents, Musa would never have objected because that was the law. But Musa didn't know that the kid was disobedient, but the righteous man knew the kid was disobedient and he ruled by the law of Moses. So when Jesus came, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala erased this law from Christianity. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala retained some of the laws that were sent to Moses in the Torah. When Muhammad, son of Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he came as a messenger with the Quran, the same thing happened. Allah erased some things from Christianity and retained some things in Christianity. Anyone who is Christian or was Christian or who read the Bible, you will find a lot of similarities, things similar to what's in the Quran, and these things is what Allah has retained. So Allah is not talking about what He has written for you or for me or whatever it is. Allah talks about the scriptures, what He has kept in them of the laws and what He has changed. That's why Allah says that Allah wipes off from a scripture to the scripture to make things easy from scripture to scripture, and retains from scripture to scripture and confirms something stays in there. And with him is the mother of the book that contains the original Quran, not in Jewish, in Hebrew, not in Aramaic, not in Arabic, but I will tell you later on inshallah in another talk what that language is. So my dear sisters, oh my God, it's 1 hour already. So because humanity, like a tiny baby, keeps growing, I think I will stop here and carry on inshallah in another talk, because it's just, I have about 20 pages and I am on page 7, so it's going to take for probably 2 or 3 other sessions. So bi-idhnillah, again, this is your brother Abdul Salam Abu Hanifa. I'm going to here to doing part 2 inshallah, and see how many parts it's going to take. I pray to Allah to bless us all, bless you. Listen to this talk a few times because it should help you become a better Muslim. Because Islam is not the way it is presented. Islam is far more beautiful, far more simple, oh my God, it's unbelievable once you connect to the Quran. And I am doing my very best to just relay that knowledge to you, and pray to Allah to bless us all. This is your brother Abdul Salam Abu Hanifa. If you want to be part of my group, you know the drill, just send me a message on my WhatsApp group, UK code +44 if you are from the international, otherwise here just 07876408735, or you can go on YouTube on my YouTube channel. It's Islam Pep Talk, and you can subscribe there and listen. I think I have like around 200 talks in there. And I'll see you on the other fence on part number 2. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.